We were discussing about the non-implantable materials, especially about the bandages. You see, we started the lecture with a discussion about the specialty fibers, that is the catgut fibers. We discussed how it is produced. Then we discussed about the polylactic acid and polyglycolic acid and what are its uses. Then we discussed about the non-implantable materials. In the non-implantable materials, we have discussed about wound care and bandages. In wound care, we have seen about the what are the wound dressings used and functions of the wound dressing and what are the layers present in the wound dressing that we have seen. So then we discussed about the materials used in the wound dressing, that is the gauze, lint, and wadding. What are these gauze, lint, and wadding, and where it is used in the wound dressing that we have seen. Then we discussed about the bandages. In bandages, there are different bandages are there. One is the normal bandage which is used for the wound dressing to hold the wound dressing, and other bandages are also we have seen, that is the compression bandage. If you see the normal bandage, it can be both woven and knitted, and these bandages have some elasticity present in them. For that, we use the elasticated fabric, that is the crepe yarns. I think you know what is meant by crepe. Crepe is a high twisted cotton yarn, so that can be used. Then we have discussed about the knitted bandages also. You can produce a tubular knitted type of a fabric, and then you can use them for bandages also. That is also one of the way. In woven bandages, you can make the fabric in such a way that by using two warp together, that is one beam you can keep under a normal tension and one beam under a high tension, so that because of that you can actually produce a high twisted type of a yarn can be produced, so that a high twisted type of fabric will have like a elasticity, with some elasticity can be produced, so that this can also be used as a bandages. So these things we have discussed yesterday. Then we started our discussion on compression bandages. So this we will go discuss it today, because many students have not answered about this compression bandages, why it is used. So from the word, you can understand what is meant by compression. Compressive force, it is applied. Compression, you know very well what is meant by compression. You compress something, you apply some compressive force to it. It is an inward force where the you give some inward force, like where in the tension you pull both the jaws, but whereas in the compression you to bring them close together, that is the compression force. So compressive forces are involved in these bandages, that is why it is called as the compression bandages. So where it is used, unlike the normal wound dressing bandages where you just hold the wound dressing, you use the wound dressing bandages, but whereas for the compression bandages you used for the treatment of deep vein thrombosis, leg ulceration, and varicose veins. What is this deep vein thrombosis? You can see here the picture. In the legs, you can see there is a inflammation here. There is a line which you can shown here, and there is a some sort of a blocks which is shown here, clots you can see here. This is a condition that forms the blood clot in the formed in the vein, that is the wherever the blood vessels where the blood is transported throughout the circulated throughout the body, there the blocks occur. So that these blocks, when it occurs, what will happen? Blood cannot freely circulate throughout the body. Okay, it can actually create a problem. If the blood clot occurs, these places will get swollen. You can see some swelling occurring in the thighs and in the backside of the leg portion. These are called the deep vein thrombosis. This is a disease. This occurs in many people. Okay, for people who have this problem, they are the affected people. This is called a leg ulcer. Okay, there are different words you can call them. It's also called as a leg ulcer, and sometimes it is also called as a varicose veins. You must have heard this word called varicose veins, where the blood vessels, that is the veins where the blood is flowing inside the human body, those blood vessels get blocked, and then that place where the blood is retained, that forms a blood gets thickened and it forms a clot. So this blood clots become a painful kind of a situation, and for that to get it resolved, what we do is we just tie the place with a bandage, so that that bandage gives some compression force that helps in the blood circulation. Because of application of bandage, the blood clots get reduced, and then blood flow is restored. So for this problem, the compression bandage is used. So that compression bandage is designed in such a way to exert a required amount of compression on the leg when applied at a constant tension. So how the compressive force happens? Because compression will come only when you apply certain pressure. Okay, so for that you also give some tension to it, so that some compressive force will occur. So this compression bandages, they are classified by the amount of compression they can exert at the ankle, and include extra high, moderate, and light compression. Depending upon the levels of compression you give, these bandages can be classified. We are going to see what are the classification. And these bandages can be either a woven and containing cotton and elastomeric yarns, or warp and weft knitted in both, or fully fashioned tubular or fully fashioned forms. This can be used. Okay, so if you see, there are some important things to understand from these compression bandages. It is not like a normal bandage which you apply to the leg so that you get the proper treatment. If you need to apply it properly, that is very important, because when you apply the compression bandage, you not only give the compression, you also give some tension as well as the high pressure. So there are some important criteria is also essential before you apply the compression bandage on the limb. For example, how much pressure you are applying, and what is the distribution of the pressure? What is the duration of the pressure? What is the radius of the limb? And what are the number of bandage layers? These are important things to consider. It is not just that where you have applied some bandage and your job is over. You need to, when you are applying, these factors should be kept in mind before you apply the compression bandage. If you see, there's the ability of a bandage to provide compression. It is determined by the construction and the tensile force generated in the elastomeric fibers when extended. So the construction of the bandage is important. And what is the tensile force that is generated? Because you are using an elastomeric fibers, which will extend when you give the tension, and it will regain back to its original position after the tensile force is removed. So that is important. And if you see, when you construct the compression bandage, the important thing to understand is the Laplace law, because the compression, how much compression you are giving, that is very important. It should not be too high, it should not be too less. If it is too less, then it will not solve the blood clot problem. If it is too high, then it will actually create the problem, it will worsen the problem, it will create more blood clot, and it will create some make the situation worser. So for that, the Laplace law understanding is important. What does this law say? It law says that pressure is directly proportional to tension, which is applied during the application, and the number of layers, that is the n, and inversely proportional to circumference and bandwidth. So here, this pressure will increase if the tension and the number of layers that you are using also increases. So these are directly proportional. You can see this is the numerator. But whereas this pressure is inversely proportional to circumference and bandwidth, that is the bandage width. What does this say? This says that if the circumference, that is the distance around the limb, that is this normally the circumference, you know very well, that is the distance around the circle. And here, the circumference is the distance around the limb, that is a leg portion. This circumference, if it increases, what will happen? The pressure will reduce. And the bandage width, if it increases, then the pressure will reduce. So this circumference and bandage width, these are inversely proportional to the pressure. And whereas this pressure is directly proportional to tension and the number of layers. So the tension and the number of layer, if it is increased, the pressure will increase. And circumference and bandage width, if it is increasing, the pressure will reduce. So this, when you design a compression bandage, when you are using it, the understanding this law is important, because without knowing this law, if you are using the bandage just randomly, if you're designing a bandage, you will not know how much type of layers you have to use or how much pressure you are applying, you will not know. So the amount of pressure that you are applying is very important, because the too high pressure will actually worsen the blood clots. So there is an expectation from the compression bandage. The ideal compression bandage should fulfill some important things. What are they? What are they? They are, it should provide appropriate compression. It should provide compression appropriate for the individual, because for all of the people will not require the same pressure. Depending upon the intensity of the problem, people may require different levels of compression. Another thing is, you need to provide pressure evenly distributed on the anatomical contours, that is the body shape. Wherever the pressure is required, that should be evenly distributed through the anatomical contours. And another thing is, the pressure should be, it should provide a gradient pressure. There should be some gradient in the pressure that should actually diminish from the ankle to the upper calf. It should be higher from the higher in the ankle portion where you require that, and it should actually start reducing. It should reduce to the upper calf, because ankle is the portion actually where this problem comes. Not only ankle, wherever in the body this blood clots are happening, that place the level of compression should be higher, and the places where the other portions, the pressure should be lower. That is why you keep a gradient and maintain the pressure and remain in position until the next change of dressing, because this pressure should be constant. So the pressure should be maintained, and it should remain in position until the next change of dressing. So once you apply the compression bandage and you are using it for a month or so, and after that you change it, so till you change it next time, the pressure should be maintained and it should remain in position. It should not get loosed. Loose structure should not get loose, and the pressure should not get reduced. And another thing is, it should extend from the base of the toes to the tibial tuberosity without gap. So from the base of the toes, it should extend to the tibial tuberosity. That is, a tibia is a bone which is in the lower part of the leg. From that toes, from the toes, if you are started applying the bandage, it should start from the toes and it should extend to the tibial bone without any kind of gap. Continuously, it should be warm. And it should function in a complementary way with the dressing. So that is important. It should be possess non-irritant and non-allergenic properties. When you apply a compression bandage, that compression bandage should be skin friendly. It should not be irritating to the skin. It should not create any kind of a itching or pricking sensation. And it should be non-allergenic. It should not create any allergy. So these points are very important. So that what are the important points when you design a compression bandage? This question people will ask you. You need to tell what an ideal compression bandage, what is expected from the ideal compression bandage. Does these things? You should know. And another important thing is, which we are going to see, is the classification of the compression bandage. So what are the classifications or the compression bandage? You can see here in the table, the left side, it is mentioned class. Middle, you can see the bandage type. Right, you can see the bandage function. So the classification of compression bandage is important. And how it is classified? It is classified by the amount of compression that is exerting at the ankle. Okay, how much is the amount of compression that is exerting? How much pressure you are giving to the particular body part, that is the ankle? So that, based on that, levels of compression, it is classified. So that is why the levels of compression is shown in the form of a class, like class 1, class 2, 3A, 3B, 3C, and 3D. These are the different classes of compression. So you can understand this class 1 is the very lowest type of a compression. And class 3D, it is the highest levels of compression. So depending upon that, you classify them. If you see this particular class 1 bandage, it is a lightweight conforming bandage. You see what is the function of this class 1 bandage? It will apply very low levels of sub-bandage pressure and are used for holding dressings in place. It is a very low level compression bandage. And the next is the light support bandage, which is a class 2 bandage. These are apply moderate sub-bandage pressure and are used to prevent edema. These are used to prevent this called, this written as OEDEMA. It is called, pronounced as edema. So this edema, it is nothing but the fluid retention in some particular places in the leg, wherever the clots are there, the blood fluids are clot. It is like a blood clot where the particular places are swollen. That is called edema. And are used for the treatment of etiology ulcers. This is also again the same type of a different condition. Okay, some disorder, you can understand. Okay, it is called the etiology ulcer. So these are nothing but the blood clots. You can understand the places where the blood or some body fluid is retained. So this class 2 bandages provide a light support so that they are applied in the moderate sub-bandage pressure. It is not a low-level pressure. In the class 1 was a low-level pressure. But whereas this one is a moderate sub-bandage pressure. Okay. So this is a class 2 type of a bandage. Okay. And these are used to prevent the edema, which is a fluid retention, or for the treatment of mixed etiology ulcers. Next is the 3A type of a class, which is a light compression. Okay. So this compression, how much compression you are applying, that is actually measured through the pressure that is exerted. Okay. How much pressure that is exerted by using this light compression, that is important. That we learn from this equation, which is the pressure, that is a millimeter mercury. This is the pressure unit. This is equal to tension kilogram force into N, which is the number of layers, and K is the constant, divided by circumference in the centimeter and multiplied by bandage width also in the centimeter. So how much pressure this will exert, that is important. When you buy a bandage, how much pressure it will it will exert, that is important. For a particular problem where you may not require a higher pressure, for that you should not go for a high pressure bandage. Okay, so depending upon the compressive force required, you classify the bandages. For example, you see in the light compression bandage, the pressure range is 14 to 17 millimeter mercury at the ankle. At this particular portion of the ankle, this is the pressure range it is applied. And moderate compression, it is the 3B class, in which the pressure required is higher. You can see 18 to 24 millimeter mercury. And high pressure is something which is 25 to 35 millimeter mercury. And 3D is the extra high compression, which is exerting a pressure of around up to 60 millimeter mercury at the ankle. If you see, this pressure ranges are lower when the class levels are lower, and the class level goes higher, the pressure also goes higher. Actually, if you see, the important thing is, for the normal problems, up to 30 to 40 millimeter mercury around this area, that is high compression bandage, for any kind of a deep vein thrombosis or blood clots, where the depending upon the severity, we can use up to high compression bandage. And for depending upon the intensity of the problem is lower, the blood clot formation, if it is lower, in that case, you can go for a moderate level of compression. So both these 3B and 3C is reduced. It is efficient in healing. It is efficient in healing most of the leg ulcer problems. That is 15 to 20 also is enough. You can see either you can go for this high compression or moderate compression for the more major part of the severe ulcers. So this extra high compression bandage is not required actually for because this is, though it is sold, but it is not required for even the severe problem. It is required for the condition if it is most severe. So this extra high compression, it is not used frequently. Okay, it is not often used. It is a very rare condition, rarest condition, where the person has a severe problem, most severe problem. In that kind of situation only, this extra high compression bandage should be used. Otherwise, this extra high compression bandage should not be used. It will create the problem. Okay, so this classification of compression bandage is important. Okay, so we will see a number of pictures of the bandages for your understanding. Yesterday itself, I have shown you in a very brief way. Today, we will see this different compression bandages and their application. You can see this is how the bandage looks like. That is the picture here, which is the elasticated flat bandage, which you will wind in the limb, leg limb. And this is for the finger. In certain people, the problem does not come in the leg. It usually comes in the finger also. So for the finger also, you can apply the bandages, which is the elasticated, which is the tubular finger bandage. And here you can see for the portions in the around the body, this tubular elasticated net garment, where in the torso portion, where they require some, where they have certain swelling problems, there they require this compression bandage. This kind of a tubular elasticated net garment can be worn. You can see here, this is how this bandages looks like, bandage packet looks like. And you see, these are the E and F, which is the orthopedic casting bandage. That is for the bone problems. People simultaneously, they get blood clots also, and also they have some injury in the bones where they require some compression. For them, this kind of a orthopedic casting bandage can be used. And for hand, this kind of a pressure gloves also there, where they require some pressure to for the blood circulation. And you can see here, this is a type of a crochet garment where the garment is completely fitting to the body. It is tightly, it is fitting to the body, which is normally called the crochet. C-R-O-C-H-E-T. You must have heard this word called a crochet type of a dressing, which will fit into the contours of the body. Wherever the whole body, they may require some compression, so that this kind of a compressive garments are also sold. This is not a bandage, it is a garment. Okay. And you see, for hips, in the hip portion also, some people may require, they have the swelling for them also, this hip spica, this kind of a bandage can be used. And here in this portion, we can apply, that is a lumbar or abdominal support, that is below the abdomen, below the stomach, abdomen portion also, this kind of bandages can be used. And the next is the anti-embolism stockings. Okay, so this is the anti-embolism type of a stocking, which you can see here in this portion. For people who cannot move, means some people who cannot walk, actually who are immobile, these kind of stockings can be used. It is called the anti-embolism stockings. Okay, so that if the person is stationary without moving, he is just taking rest, that time also this anti-embolism stocking, they actually provide the blood help for in the during the blood circulation, even if the person is immobile. Okay, so these are the different types of stockings which is used. So if you see in this compression bandages, there are other bandages also there, like we have seen, which is the orthopedic cushion bandages. That is for people who have this type of a bone problem. That is called the orthopedic, is nothing but the bone problem. For them, this, they are used under the plaster cast. For example, if some people have a leg fracture, any kind of a bone that is broken or injury that has happened, for them, this plaster casts are used. You must have known this word called a plaster, which is a plaster of Paris. Plaster of Paris is used. For them also, this compression bandages can be used below the plaster cast, so that it will provide some padding and prevent discomfort. Okay, you can see in the picture, this is how it looks like. For example, in a particular leg portion, if someone has a fracture, so that below, before applying the plaster, they apply the compression bandage so that it will give some padding and comfort, so that over that they can apply the plaster. And this non-woven orthopedic bandages, this can be produced from a different textile materials like polyurethane foams, rubber materials, polyester, polypropylene, and also contain the blends of natural and synthetic fibers. And for non-wovens, these are needle punched, lightly needle punched to maintain the bulk and the soft. And there are some developments taking place in the cushion bandage materials containing fully engineered needle punched type of a band structure when compared to the existing materials. So these are the orthopedic cushion bandages. So there are other bandages also. You can see the multi-layer compression systems, which is called the many layers are wound in the leg limb. But in the places like UK, these are recommended for the treatment of venous leg ulcers, that is the varicose type of veins where the blood clots are more. So this compression, multi-layer compression systems, though it is effective in giving you the solving the problem, if you see, it is generally agreed that these are too bulky for the patients and cost involved is very high. This is a disadvantage with the Multi-layer bandages. Because you see, if you increase the number of layers, the patient will feel that it is too bulky and heavy, so that it will be difficult for them to walk. And also, the cost involved is also very high, because if the person wants to change the bandage frequently, they have to spend more money for that. So for that, it is generally agreed that the multi-layer bandages are too bulky for the patients, and the cost involved is very high. So there are a wide range of bandages are available with the different properties, and variations are also there in the bandages. So generally, you see the compression bandage, when you apply the tensile force, it will expand when the calf muscle pump is exercised, and beneficial effect of the calf muscle pump, it is dissipated. So that is when the person is wearing a bandage and doing any kind of a physical activity, that time during the stretching expansion, this pump, calf muscle pump, when it is excised, this will expand and it will dissipate the tension throughout the body. And you see, there are short stretch bandages also, which is actually a type 2 type of a system. Which is an inelastic bandage. Okay, this is a different type of a bandage, which is just called a short stretch bandage. These bandages, if you see, it is called type 2 type of a system. So this short stretch means in a short stretch itself, it will expand. You can apply them throughout the leg portion. Full stretch, that is up to 90%, it will extend for a short stretch. Though it is inelastic, it will just applying the full stretch around the limb. Here, the thing is, unlike the multi-layer compression system, it will not expand when the calf muscle is expand. You can see here, this is the important thing. When the calf pump muscle pump is exercised, they do not expand when the calf muscle pump is expand, and force of the muscle is directed back to the leg, which promotes venous return. So here it is different from the multi-layer compression bandage. You can see this multi-layer compression bandage, it is a long stretch type of a bandage. It will tend to expand when the calf muscle pump is exercised. That is, the calf pump, calf muscle is nothing but, you know very well, the backside portion of the leg, that is called the calf muscle. Just like your triceps in your hand. So that bandages in the long stretch, they because of the long stretch, whenever you apply you force, what will happen? These bandages tend to expand when this pump when this calf muscle pump is exercised, and they have the beneficial effect of calf muscle pump, so that it will dissipate. But whereas you see in the short stretch bandages, they do not expand, because even for a short stretch, it is expanding to the maximum extent. That is a full stretch, so that it is extended to 90%, so that after that, there is less scope for extending. So they do not expand when the calf muscle pump is exercised, and the force of the muscle is directed back to the leg itself, which promotes the venous return. So this do not dissipate the energy. So there are some limitations associated with the short stretch bandages. That is, for a small increase in the volume of the leg will result in the large increase in the compression. That is, the bandage will provide higher compression in the upright position and little or no compression in the recumbent position. That is, when the person is standing, the pressure will be much higher when it is in the not in the upright position, that is in the recumbent position. The pressure will not reduce. And also during the activities like walking or other exercises, this pressure will rise steeply, and at the rest, the pressure will reduce. So these are the disadvantages associated with the short stretch bandages. And the patients must be mobile. Always, the person who is wearing the short stretch bandages, he should be mobile. Then only it will give the high levels of compression. So the compression will not be maintained throughout the activity. That is, when the person is doing the activity, it will be higher, the compression will be higher, and when he relaxes, it will get reduced. So these are the shortcomings of the short stretch bandages. So in that situation, the long stretch bandages are much effective, so that will maintain the pressure in, under any situation, whether the person is doing an activity or he is not doing an activity. So normally, if you see, if in the compression bandages, they have an extension up to 200%. They are applied to extension of about 200% are applied at 50% extension, and 50% overlap to achieve the desired pressure of the limb. So these compression bandages, they have a higher extension percentage, that is 200%. They are normally applied at 50% extension and 50% overlap, so that depending upon the desired pressure that is required for the limb, these are applied at a different percentage of pressure, that is the 50% extension and 50% overlap. Okay, that is, overlap is nothing but where you apply first layer and then over that you apply another layer. Okay, so when the these bandages are used, it is always a problem for the nurses who apply these bandages when they stretch these bandages from ankle to calf, because from the lower portion it is start winding to the upper portion, from the ankle to the calf. You can see in the bandage, just there are some rectangles printed on the bandages. You may, if you see the bandages, you can understand it. Because of the application of higher pressure, these rectangles will try to become a big squares, so that the desired stretch maintaining is difficult. Okay. Because these are the indicators which are shown in the, as a picture in the bandages, that is, the rectangles are shown. So if you apply higher pressure, what will happen? These rectangles will, because of the pulling, it will become like a big square. So there normally there are some problems associated with this short stretch bandages when you, when the nurses are using it. The desired level of stretch is a problem with the short stretch bandages. Okay, so these are the things. And nowadays there are some recent developments are coming to solve these problems with the bandages. What are they? These are the research and developments which are happening in the places like scientists, scientific organization like University of Bolton. They are developing these smart single layer novel compression therapy. By using only a single layer of a garment, whether you can make a compression, is it possible? So this is the research. Rather than using a multi-layer bandage and making the leg much bulkier and difficulty for the patients, whether it is possible to use a bandage with a single layer compression system, that is the challenge. And this University of Bolton, they have developed this compression bandages. It is called the novel single layer compression system. This is different from the conventional two layer bandages. You can see here, this is the two layer bandage and this is the new 3D spacer bandage. So these are the recent developments using the spacer fabrics. These are the three dimensional knitted spacer fabrics which are used in the compression bandages. So before going into that, you should know what is mean by a spacer type of a fabric. What is this spacer fabric? So spacer fabric contain a combination of textile sheet and distance fibers with a porous structure. You can see this contains a textile sheets and distance fiber so that they have a pore structure. It has a three-dimensional shape. Because of that porous structure, they have the higher absorption capacities. So if you see, when a person is using the compression bandage, it is not only that it gives the compressive force and his problem is solved. It should also be comfortable to the leg portion, because the microclimatic properties are very important. Microclimate means what? That is between the skin and the garment. For that reason, this spacer fabrics are used, and they have found that it is much better to use the spacer fabrics. And if you see, the spacer fabrics, they are often monofilament polyester fibers. They have the desired stiffness, and they can resist higher pressure. And important thing is, they can transport the fluid and the heat, because when the bandage is applied, the person leg also undergoes perspiration. It generates heat. The heat is dissipated from the heat is going out from the body. So they can, because of the porous structure of this 3D knitted fabrics, the pressure also can be resisted, and the moisture vapor also can go out. The heat also can go out from the body. So if you see, these are comfortable to wear, and when used on the patients, skin sweating is prevented due to the microclimatic quality of the spacer fabrics. Here the moisture vapor transmission, it is very good in this spacer fabric because of the porous structure. Okay, so both the things are achieved from this. One is the pressure that is required, whatever the desired pressure that is required, that you are getting it. And also the person who is wearing it, it is only a single layer of a bandage. So you do not require two layers actually to be used, so that is also make the situation comfortable. So this is a success. So if you see, normally the multi-layer or a short stretch bandage, whichever you are using, which are the 2D type of a woven or knitted or cross-shirted fabric, which is tightly fitting to the leg portion, spacer fabric, it is a 3D, which has a top and bottom layers of a fabric, which is connected with the filament yarns, which is a polyester yarns, so that they have a corrugated box type of a structure. I will show you the picture in the next class. It has a 3D structure. So this corrugated box 3D structure, it is very advantageous. With a single layer, you can achieve multiple properties. That is, the treatment time is reduced, and financially, the person with a single layer, once it is applied, it is good. So that it is a replacement for the current multi-layer bandage system. So this is a advantage. You can replace the current multi-layer bandage system that has certain advantages, but the disadvantage is you have to apply more layers, and also it is bulky and costly also. For that, the laborious process of a two-layer system, it is overcome by using this 3D-based single-layer type of a compression bandage system. But commonly, it is a four-layer, multi-layer systems are used in many places, but this is under research, and it has achieved success to replace the conventional bandages. Okay, so these are the recent developments that has taken place in this past decade, and some researches are done in this compression bandage field. Okay, so this is all about the compression bandages. Okay, so I have explained, I think, in detail about what is a compression bandage, what is deep vein thrombosis, what is a varicose vein, how it can be overcome, and what an ideal compression bandage should work, how it should work, what is expected from that, and what are the different classification of compression bandage, what is a Laplace law, what is the importance of pressure, and what are the short stretch bandage, what is a multi-layer bandage, and what are the recent developments. So I think I have explained this compression bandage in detail to you. I hope you have understood. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Do you have any doubts? Please. please share recorded lecture. Okay, fine. I will share the recorded lecture. Okay, I will send the recorded lecture to you. I will put that in the YouTube. Okay, I will do that. So, any other questions or anything? So, are you reading the PPTs for the exams? The post-midterm syllabus will come, which I have already told you, that is the ballistic protection. Then comfort properties of textiles. For both of the ballistic and comfort properties, I have already shared the PPTs to you. And then this medical textiles, which will take some 2-3 classes to finish this medical textiles. So these 3 units plus the pre-midterm portions, 75 to 25 ratio, the questions will be set. So keep reading the PPTs. I will also share this medical textile PPT in another 2 classes. I will share the PPT to you. Keep reading it is also in the books, in the textbook also. So we will discuss further in the next class. Thank you.